all, and thank you for joining us for the webinar, Design Thinking in Recruitment, the Honeywell Stories, Keep User Experience at the Center. Partnership with PeopleStrong. This is Rika from People Matters. And moving to the agenda of the day, let me give you a brief of the topic. For a global brand with reach across multiple locations and time zones, the right talent at the right time is a Herculean task. The trick is to keep different users, like hiring managers, recruiters, engaged in order to deliver business benefits. Here are Honeywell, a Fortune 100 software industrial technology leader, managed hiring talent and manages hiring right and fast. While delivering a seamless user experience in the process. This will cover the business aspect, how it all works, its impact, and what's next in recruitment. Let me introduce the speakers for this webinar. That's great. Sorry, technical glitch. We'll back to you very shortly. Good morning. Thank you for joining us for the webinar. I'm thinking in recruitment, Honeywell story, keeping the experience at the center in partnership with PeopleStrong. Rika from People Matters, and before moving to the agenda of the day, let me give you a brief of the topic. When you're a global brand with reach across multiple locations and time zones, hiring the right talent at the right time is a Herculean task. The trick is to keep different users, like hiring managers, recruiters, engaged in order to deliver business benefits. Here is how Honeywell, a 400 software industrial talent technology leader, manages hiring right and fast while delivering a seamless user experience in the process. The webinar will cover the business context, how it all worked, impact, and what's next in recruitment. Let's introduce the speakers for this webinar. We have the privilege of having with us Anshu Vastava, SSI Vice President, RPO, Same Solutions, PeopleStrong HR Services, Sumit Rawal, Director Staffing at Honeywell India. Vastava comes with over 16 years of experience in business management, consulting, recruitment, and manpower outsourcing. He handled recruitment across industry verticals and is experienced professional in setting and managing mid to large multi-location teams, business development, client relations and engagement, team mentoring and coaching, and revenue management and cost management across industries. Sumit Rawal has over 4 years of experience in various human resources functions like talent and organization development, performance management, compensation, lead, acquisition and staffing, employee relations and HR operations. She works with multiple business groups with Honeywell and has leadership experience in dealing with various talent management and organization structure issues. She continues operating in global environment in a matrix and virtual setup. She also had exposure to strategy formulation and execution and implementing organization-wide processes. She is a belt certified professional in Honeywell. Our partners for today's webinar is PeopleStrong. In 2005, PeopleStrong is leading HR solutions and technology company from India, delivering cutting-edge technology enable HR solutions in the space of recruitment and lifecycle management, sales and compliance management, and analytics. The company's enriching experience of over 175 plus customers and over 500,000 users for over a decade now. Known for its mission to innovate, PeopleStrong has many firsts. The recent one being India's first native HR app, which aims to transform the future of work and work life across corporates and organizations. We save time for you to ask questions at the end of the webinar. For those attending the live webinar, you can submit questions at any time during the presentation through the Q&A section. We will try to respond to as many questions as time permits. We have an exciting topic to discuss at this webinar today. So without any further delay, let me invite Sumitha to take over. Over to you, Sumitha.
Thank you, Ritika. So as we start, I'm going to talk briefly about what is all about, and then what has been our focus area in this journey. So it is about 131 lakh employees across the world. We are headquartered at Morris Plain, New Jersey, and a Fortune 100 company. Four main business units from where I make our money, and as you know, most of that comes from aerospace. So we are into aerospace, into human building technologies, performance materials and technologies, and safety and productivity solutions. Majority of our sales comes from aerospace, wherein we get close to about $14.8 billion, followed by homes and building technology, which is about $10.7 billion in sales, performance and material technology, which is about $9.3 billion in sales, and safety and productivity solution, which is $4.6 billion in sales. Overall, end-to-end technology companies and have multiple unmatched scope of offerings across various business lines. If I have to talk briefly about each of the business lines to kind of give you a flavor, it would be typically in the areas of, say, aerospace, when anything from, say, nose to tail is on mechanical, and cockpit management is something which we kind of offer. We are also into application, service, maintenance, and end-to-end connectivity from a hardware airtime standpoint. There is a small business group on turbo chargers, which is also part of the aerospace organization, which is responsible for fuel efficiency, is something which we also work on as part of aerospace. Homes and buildings predominantly takes care of the security and the sensors aspect of homes and buildings. We work a big way in connected homes technologies as well. And a lot to do with Internet of Things and how we can connect the overall Internet or cloud applications with the products which we have within the organization. Performance materials and technology is typically on the oil and gas sector, a lot to do with refineries and how do we kind of work around connected plant technologies. And last but not the least, again, safety and productivity solution is with connecting workers across plants and different industries. So if you see our logo, it's about the power of being connected, and that's what Honeywell kind of does across all business units and technology. India, briefly, we are around 15,000 employees strong organization, which definitely includes close to about 8,000 engineers, about $1 million in sales currently, and currently working close to about 3,000 product solutions and applications in place. We are spread across India with close to about 7 manufacturing facilities. universities and 5 global technology development centers. We are typically or, you know, predominantly present in Bangalore, Pune, Chennai, Gurgaon, and definitely, you know, Hyderabad, Madurai, and Dehradun as well. All four business banks of Honeywell is present in India, and hence we do end up hiring for all of them. So coming to the topic for today, if I have to give you a picture of the kind of hiring needs which this organization has, it ranges from technology hiring to engineering hiring, of course, various aspects of, say, marketing, sales, business, and also plant hiring. So the end-to-end hiring of various technologies, various domains, various business units, which we end up doing for India Honeywell. From a number standpoint, I would say it's close to about 3,500 to 4,000 hires in a year, typically about 350 to 400 hirings per month, which we do. Moving a quick view on the focus areas before I hand over to Anshuman, because this is something wherein we started our journey with PeopleStrong and also started focusing on staffing and recruitment in a systematic way for the organization. The key focus areas were 6 for us at Honeywell. Definitely wanted to improve engagement in staffing. And I say improve engagement, it was more in terms of how do we provide a high-touch staffing environment, and how do we ensure that hiring manager and candidate satisfaction is seemingly addressed while we do that high-touch recruitment process for the group. Rapid and fast staffing solution, definitely business expectation was shorter cycle time. How do we ensure that we get people extremely right and fast? How do we eliminate waste in staffing process? How do we see that wherever there is a issue with respect to additional processes, additional steps, more time being taken to kind of get a right candidate on board? How do we eliminate waste, make the process much more leaner? Of your profile. So first past yield, how many hit ratios we are having, and whether we are able to really pick people with the first set of files which we receive was a big ask from us. Strong governance, we were extremely diversified across as a country as well. So they say that it's Honeywell India, but then it's like 6 to 7 different legal entities, and each business used to operate in their own. So the complexity was extremely high, and one of the asks was to how do we standardize and how do we centralize all our staffing processes so that the experience is uniform across, and hence a strong governance to make sure that happens, process improvements and through specific governance. Business-specific governance review, challenging status quo. Fourth one is on analytics and insight. Definitely, whenever we work with the external partner on large database, that is one of the big asks from the organization, that how do we look at the current data? Do we get some predictive analytics? Do we get some, artificial intelligence from the data, which is currently there in the system, and if we can do something differently from that. The fifth one was on tighter delivery. So at any point in time, for the business, boots on ground were the main ask, that whether how many people I have at any point in time. And for us, it was very crucial that any point in time, we are able to fill 90% of their ask and follow a factory model of first in, first out, kind of approach. So a very strong focus on tight delivery. Last but not the least, recruiter stability, right? Because this goes a long way to have a very stable staffing organization and to ensure that at any point in time, we don't have a recruiter seat vacant so that we are able to meet business needs. So that's pretty much what our focus area had been. request Ritika to hand over to Anshuman the presentation so that he can take it over for the next slide.
Anshuman, you can begin with your slides and we can continue the discussion.
Sure. Thank you for the introduction. So we PeopleStrong, we looked into all the statements that came to us when we initiated the RPO engagement. And while we created the solution, guys, we looked at one aspect at the core of it. In operations, it is very likely that we become extremely outcome-driven at certain point in time. Almost at all points in time, we are chasing offers, we are chasing time, turnaround times, etc. While we do all that and while we chase outcomes, it's imperative that we keep the user experience at the center. The solution principle that we created kept that at the core. Whatever actions we perform, whatever track we created, keep in mind the fact that the user experience should be high. The user experience has to be at the core of the entire journey that we provide. So I request the group to look at all the solution tracks in that context. User at the center, telling an experiential recruitment solution. That's what how we solutionize the entire solution. As there in the slide, you can look at the we looked at a couple of elements, supply structure, people, process, data engagement. A lot of it flew from what Sumedha just mentioned about her problem statements about Honeywell, what Honeywell wanted us to do at in terms as a partner. I mean, we look at CV supply is the most important aspect in any recruiting operating job, and while recruiters of course work on the CV supply forum, we said we create a solution around a dedicated COE structure, dedicated sourcing arm providing CV supply crowdsourcing solutions. By crowdsourcing we mean providing this last mile CV supply solution. For instance, Honeywell, as Sumedha mentioned, is a diversified spread out organization. There are requirements in as locations like Vadodara, for example. If we were looking for an oil and gas professional in Vadodara, we needed recruiters sometimes or sources on the ground. The crowdsourcing network enabled us to last mile connectivity, that last mile reach, and improve our supply and connectivity. We also put up what we call as a central employee reference cell. When we look at any supply solution, of course, you can source CVs externally. You also look at a lot of internal CV mining. How can those CVs be appropriately used, appropriately mined, and therefore we set up an employee reference centrally and ensure that the referrals were being taken care of and referral numbers are looking pretty healthy. We structure in people as the next in a couple of points when we looked at role of people. What kind of role do people perform? Recruiters should perform engagement, while as I mentioned earlier, sourcing QA is performed the job of handling the CV supply. We set up an onboarding function also, and it's a very important initiative in the Honeywell RPO scheme of things. We said the recruiters perform engagement, sourcers supply the CV, let the onboarding team manage the job of releasing the offers, post-offer engagement, post-offer coordination, and all the formalities. These three as a tripod work together and deliver the seamless solution that we were talking about. Diversity was an important ask in Honeywell, and therefore we centrally drove diversity as an agenda, creating a spot to supply sufficient diversity CV. Some of the SBUs are extremely diversity-friendly, while some of them tend to be not so diversity-friendly in terms of the talent availability. It was important that while the teams on the ground met numbers, supply CVs, is a dedicated focus on diversity, and therefore that came in very important. Campus, which is UR, the university relations, that is driven centrally. UR is an important component. Honeywell hires about 500 people annually from campuses, and we looked at a central team driving this agenda campuses to go, how do you brand Honeywell there, what kind of engagements do you run, and how do you execute the entire event. Needless to say, the campus also helps us impact the diversity agenda in the Honeywell scheme of things. The process and metrics and the long list of things that we did, of course, SLAs, KPI, process standardization, I mean, ensuring that while the solution gets delivered, the teams are based in Bangalore, Pune, Gurgaon, all locations. It's a blend of on-site, off-site model, and therefore, how do we deliver standardized deliveries across geographies, across businesses, and therefore, process was standardized. They were monitored and audited to ensure that as a customer, every felt that the service was being delivered in one way, in one form across businesses. Multiple process interventions we've done. I'll talk about some critical ones in the future slide. But largely, guys, the take was that look at process, identify NVAs, kill those NVAs, make the process lean, make process lean and smart. So I'll talk about some of these interventions as I move ahead. Medha mentioned that team stability was an important element, and Honeywell being a high-touch organization, how is the entire exit entry of a new resource, exit or existing and an entry for a new resource managed? How do you ensure that the end user doesn't get impacted by that, and that we create the entire process on the entry of new members in the RPO team, and how the exit is going to happen, what kind of handoffs will happen, how it will happen. Again, the intent was the end user should see a seamless, effortless handover, and there should not be glitches around that. So we worked on that. It was an important intervention. Another important thing is set up, and I'm now moving a little from the process to the numbers, actually. We started setting up business-wise monthly targets. If we X number of recs, how many of those recs will we offer close within the month? We started this practice and across businesses set up monthly offer targets, and this offer were further divided into which would be diversity offer. So the target setting process was put in place. The teams are aligned on the numbers and the targets, and the teams know that as a process every month, there is an offer target, there's a diversity target which has to be delivered and chased. We set up a benchmark that will be 90% on rec fulfillment, which means if 100 recs are open, we will close 90 of them within the month. That's the kind of right and fast solution we wanted to deliver. That's the kind of speed we wanted to adopt. And mostly we've been able to do the 90% fulfillment month. The teams are aligned and the teams deliver on that number month and month. While we delivered everything in speed and all this stuff and keeps means again at the core, initial process that all voice of customer inputs, all escalations, all complaints are logged at a central place. They are monitored centrally, reviewed, and I kind of present it out to Sumedha and other stakeholders what we're doing on those VOCs. There's a formal mechanism to track VOCs, track outcomes, and formally close a VOC. Again, imperative, because if you're delivering experience, you can't get it without having a central VOC monitoring mechanism. Data, like Sumedha mentioned, it's an extremely important task, and you can't run a recruiting operation without data. So multiple, we'll talk of this data part more in detail in the ensuing slide, but we use a combo of weekly flashes, dashboard, delay reports, etc., etc. Largely the intent was, guys, if anything is not visible, it can't be controlled, it can't be impacted. And therefore, we ensure that we use a plethora of flashes and data and dashboards and flash it to multiple stakeholders so that you're able to drive that, yes, this is where things are not going right, this is where it needs immediate impact. That has been one of the most important elements in being able to deliver the numbers that we have been able to. The engagement part, and I mean, like any outsourcing structure, we have a spoke-to-spoke mapping, and we have defined review governance framework. We'll talk of more about engagement and review framework also in the ensuing slides. We also looked at agenda co-creation, and it's very important that when you deliver an agenda in any outsourcing relationships, there are multiple stakeholders, user departments involved. Are we going to build buy-in of all those and kind of so it helped us in creating that agenda, and together we went and be it the HR team, be it the business team, build buy-in. And with HR, we work very closely. In fact, co-create the agenda with HR so that largely everybody is aligned with what we want to deliver, what we want to achieve, and how do you want to do that. This is what essentially what we looked at as the solution along these buckets. I'll try and further was to look at, while this was the last track of things, what were the key things that made the difference? Within the overall solution principle, what are the key differences that made the difference? And my next slide talks about that. You'll see elements of the solution principle here. Here as well. You can see the first element we looked at was communication, and I use this word over communicate. There is nothing in a relationship like an RPO kind of an engagement. I don't think there's anything called communicate, or there's less communication. You have to communicate. You have to over-communicate, in fact, like I've emphasized. So a number of forums we created, which was a combination of reviews, roadshows, workshops, VOCs, etc., to ensure that communication lines were always buzzing. There were clear-cut, transparent processes moving. People were aware. People were aware of what is happening. Everything was visible. Let's talk about some of the A very important intervention was that setting up the weekly business reviews and a weekly ops review that we set up. While the businesses got reviewed with respective spots on a week, at the central level, me and Mehta ran a weekly ops review also, in which we kind of bullet all action items, put across actionables, and at a central level, so we're able to monitor and see where are we at a macro level, how are we moving, and the scorecard gets flashed every week to the stakeholders. We set up a bi-monthly steercom. I mean, we're often used to, in fact, initially we are doing a weekly steercom also. We all are used to steercom being run maybe once a month or once a quarter, perhaps, in certain RPO relationships or outsourcing relationships. As I said, the emphasis was to over-communicate. That we had a weekly steercom running for almost 7-8 months, and then we shifted to a bi-monthly frequency of the same. Again, at a central level, be able to monitor movements. The data and dashboards, as I mentioned earlier, were the second element that made a lot of difference. Weekly diversity flash, KPIs were flashed every week, there's a business delay tracking flash, intake meeting adherence flash, multiple flashes, multiple dashboards, multiple inputs that we run and keep educating, keep talking to all stakeholders about how we are performing. The third element was the alignment element, which I spoke, as I said, extremely important and critical that we align all stakeholders, HR and staffing. It's an ongoing process. We give monthly targets to the teams. There is an HR team also which gets impacted by those numbers, and therefore are we building buy-in of those numbers before we go ahead and announce it to the entire universe. I think that was an important initiative, and Sumedha was very helpful in helping us build that buy off our folks in this entire agenda. We did a number of process interventions, and the list is endless, but I'll pick up three of the most important part. One was re-engineered the entire process in which the recs get assigned, and that was an opportunity element, because where the recs get open and what's the gap and how quickly do you get assigned? We can lose 1 or 2 or 3 days also if the recs don't get assigned immediately. It's open somewhere in the system, and if left to 1 or 2 people to assign it and not monitored, you can lose 1 or 2 days it's impacting your TTF eventually. We set up a traffic cop process in India, which was different, and we made sure the delivery managers themselves assigned the rec in time. There's a flash that goes every day in the system, which passes to the staffing team and to the RPO team. Recs are not assigned within one day. We kind of rag that red and immediate flashes go out that there's a deal here. The process was extremely well engineered and controlled. We've been able to save precious days which would have otherwise gotten lost. Has not happened. As I mentioned, role realignment, we realigned the role of recruiters and offers and sourcers and ensured that the tripod resulted in the right outcomes, the right people focus on the right interventions. Recruiters shouldn't focus on creating offers or running BVs or coordinating for medical. They focus on what they're good at, which is engagement, talent supply, talent advisory. So I think that was an important process intervention. And then, of course, it's a going process. We keep reviewing the processes. We keep reviewing and keep adding interventions. Team capability, team stability need extremely important agenda, and we use a multiple forums to engage and make our teams more capable. I won't read out all of them. There's a set of reward recognitions, quarterly town halls, a set of entire activities and engagement and R&R framework, which ensures that the guys who actually perform the job on the ground are engaged, are extremely excited, and receive all the inputs that are needed. We run co-anchor training programs with the Honeywell team. I mentioned two of them. One is a domain certification program that we are running for all our team members, which is an ongoing thing. And second is a behavioral training program, which we call it Pride series of sessions. Sumedha and her team, we co-anchor along with them and deliver. These are weekly, twice a month or monthly programs, so the recruiters see that there is a visible value add happening as they work with Honeywell and PeopleStrong. To the solution journey now, I mean, in terms of, I've spoken about what was our solution we looked at, but the key thing that made the difference, I mentioned when I started off, the emphasis was on experience. Outsourcing relationships tend to start with efficiency. How do you evolve to an experiential RPO is something that we endeavor to take the journey on, and I'll briefly talk about that journey. When we did the journey, our version one of our design of our structure was about recruiters and processors, in which recruiters were doing the sourcing and offer creation and processors were doing the post-offer coordination. A very simple model. Intent was just deliver, maintain numbers, deliver the efficiencies, get the metrics in control, and keep maintaining the numbers. That was the first version we started for the first 3-4 months. We evolved this into what we called as the next journey in any outsourcing relationship, which is about efficiencies are getting in control. Can we start or can initiate engagement? It's not that engagement wouldn't be happening earlier, but with efficiencies and metrics in control or looking like to be in control, can we start the higher order ask of also talking more and more to the businesses, to the customers and engagement? So our next model was when we broke the role into three parts. The recruiters to do sourcing, engagement, be accountable for metrics. The sourcers will do the CV supply and talent mapping, and the onboarding focus will do the offer creation and the post-offer coordination. We were on journey, and then we looked at version 2.0, is actually what we are executing right now, in which we have, again, the three buckets. However, the sourcing function has been completely segregated. The sourcing function lies entirely with the sourcing CUE, making recruiters free to engage and your experience. That is the intention, that recruiters should be accountable. The front end, the guys who are there talking to customers, should be accountable only for three things: how efficient are your metrics, engage with the stakeholders, tell an experiential recruitment solution, be supported by sourcers. So, and the transaction of sourcing is to be performed by the sourcers, and the onboarding specialist perform the job of doing the post-selection coordination. And that's how it has been covered the last few years when we started in 2016 till date. Sumedha, you can add at any point in time if you if there are any inputs that you want to put on.
No, I'm good. Please proceed.
Sure. I quickly talk about what we were when we started, and we looked at, and guys, you should look at this journey right from the efficiency metrics being controlled and the experience outcomes being targeted now. What we were in 2015 and when we started off the relationship. Talk of the numbers, we were at an AOP manning number of 94%. Early fills, for this knowledge of the audience, early fills is part of TTF only. We look at a TTF of a certain number. We said a certain set of recs have to close even earlier than the TTF target. So if the TTF target was 53 days, captain requisitions close within 40 days. Because in any group of requisition, you'll always have those 100 days plus recs also. You can't close every rec at 53 days also. You need to have some recs closing under 40 days to be able to provide that leverage to the recs which are aging. So that's a concept that we picked up and set up targets. We were in an early fill percentage of 43%. TTF 61 days, vendor hiring 26, diversity was 24. And we were running a satisfaction score of 6.9 on the hiring manager and an 8.2 of the candidate community. Sumedha, would you like to take up the outcomes? I'll kind of run the slides.
Yeah. So thanks, Anshuman. And I think all of you would agree. I mean, whatever we have been doing, unless and until we see an outcome in terms of metrics, it doesn't really matter, right? And for the business, the best way to look at a staffing performance is how far and how easy I'm getting my position filled. So I'm glad to kind of share these numbers with you, and I think this has been typical for a period of, close to about 2 years now, wherein we've been able to achieve that. So Anshuman did speak about some of the metrics which we were at the beginning of the engagement, and what you see on the right-hand side is something what we are now currently. So when I AOP, AOP is nothing but, sensors. So from sensors fulfillment standpoint, where do we stand? And if you see, we are currently at 96% and of course, heading towards a close to a 98% kind of a target. It might be some attrition in the quarter four or so. The fills has been very good for us. We have been filling positions faster, so close to 50% of our positions we have been able to fill within the defined timeline. TTS is nothing but total time to fill, so which is currently at 43 days against 61 when we started. Our agency filling has also gone down a lot, and this is another area wherein our business really values from staffing, because we expense a certain amount of cost when we partner with RPO, and agency cost is an addition to that, right? So if you're able to bring down the agency cost, ensuring that our direct sourcing through RPO partner kind of goes up, really bring dollar value back to the business. So we have been really able to reduce from 26 to 10%. Diversity hiring, I think Anshuman touched upon it, has been a big focus area, and you see there are some improvements there as well, and last but not the least on the candidate and HM SAT. Having said that, I think We are in a stage wherein, of course, we started with learning, we adopting new practices, experimenting, running prototypes, and if we are failing, just, you know, changing it again and doing it in a different way. So extremely, I would say, agile way of getting things done, quickly learning, adopting, and then sharing whatever we have learned, and then, of course, guiding the rest of the organization so that we are able to maintain a steady performance. And of course, having said that, this is not the end. I mean, though we started on this journey, there's still lots to achieve overall, say, experience and satisfaction standpoint, which we are, of course, learning to kind of get that and that going as well. So this is not something wherein we have, you know, the best in kind of a score, but definitely something wherein we have learned and we have improved from where we started our journey in 2015. Next slide. Okay, moving on, and this would be our last slide before we kind of open up for Q&A. Right? And as I said, I think continuous improvement, challenging status quo, and while, you know, looking at something through an innovative lens is something which we need to keep on if we need to kind of ahead of the game. I always believe that while journey excellence is very, very tough, but staying on the spot of excellence for a long time is tougher, right? So it's important to kind of continuously innovate. And with that focus in mind, these are some of the new things which we are kind of focusing on. I'm sure being in the industry, all of you would have heard about these as well. So not something new, but then definitely this is where the industry is moving from a staffing standpoint. So things which we have tried in 2017 is, of course, mapping of identified skills. We have a list of critical skills with us, and we have started doing proactively pipeline on those skills so that we don't end up, you know, losing time when those kind of recs are open. So really leveraging a lot on predictive analytics to kind of get that done. The second thing is on video CVs. A lot of time our managers are keen to see the person in person and then take a call. And most of the time, because of time gaps, time differences, they are not able to do that. So not to delay the staffing process, we have introduced video CVs for some of our hiring. Where a manager, when they see the CV for the first time, they see a video interview as well of that person. And that enables us to move faster because a manager is able to quickly take a call looking at how the person has done the video interview and move ahead in the process. Thirdly, we have started a lot on technical assessment. We do a huge number of software hiring. We do a huge number of, I would say, technical hiring. And most of the time, apart from the interviews, we also do a lot of evidence-based hiring. So the technical assessments, online assessments, play for us to pick up guys whom we usually call hackathons. We have been doing hackathons for almost close to a year now for our technical and software hiring, and this has been, I think, one of the new things which has really helped us get the right talent in the organization. Some remaining focus, and these are ongoing focus for us this year, diversity, I'll not harp about it more because this is definitely a critical area for us. How do we optimize source mix? As I said, improving source and looking at other mechanisms as well. How do we improve referral channel? How do we really improve our internal job channel and reduce dependency on agency to provide dollar value back to the business is a constant focus area for us. And of course, but not the least, the overall hiring manager. That's the end, I would say, objective of whatever we put in place, that are able to give a wow experience to our managers. And should we talk about the next aspect in terms of whatever we'll focus on in 2018?
Some of the elements you've captured, not all, of course, but some of the elements we're looking at. As we look at rejuvenating the way referrals happen in Honeywell RPO and continue our focus on the referral as an important source of reasons that come to us, we're looking at app-enabled referral program, and we're already preparing the blueprint around that and should go live shortly, that we'll enable each of the Honeywell members to have an app. Everybody uses a smartphone and therefore have an app, and the person will be able to refer CVs, track how the referrals are moving on the app itself, and we'll make it very exciting. We're looking at, so we're working with Sudan on working out this solution. We feel that referrals will be a big thing once we are able to implement the app-based solution in the Honeywell RPO. We are also looking at creating a, what we call as a job description and a CTQ repository. Guys, CTQ implies critical to quality. So we look at a job description. After through it, we use an intake thing as a forum with the hiring manager to create a set of key asks about the position. Those key asks are what we call CTQ. Can be a lengthy document, try and bucketize or bulletize it into 5 or 6, what are the key things that we are looking for. So we are working on a solution where we create an ecosystem and a central repository of all job descriptions and their CTQs somewhere. Once we're able to execute this, I think it will enable us to do phenomenal amount of analysis, phenomenal amount of contextual data will come to us. A lot of interesting insights could be delivered if I'm able to, cut through all the 400-500 job description and their CTQs together. So that's one step in building up institutional memory, as we call it, of the recruiting organization. So we are on the job on that. We've initiated that. The third quick bit is the campus hiring, and it's a very important focus area for Honeywell this year and ahead also, that we hire 500 people from campus, and therefore the entire program of how the engagement will happen has been anchored. We have created a blueprint, and we are executing this right now as we are talking in 2017. Fourth critical element which we are working on is behavioral assessments. We already do technical assessments for all our recruiting recruitments. We are also looking at behavioral assessments. Honeywell has recently, 2017, moved into 8 behavioral traits that an ideal Honeywell employee should possess or should ideally be possessing them and should be measured on. And we are looking at creating a scientific framework around that, so that interviews and behavioral assessment enable it to get the right talent with the right speed and the right efficiencies. Mind. Thank you. We can the questions.
Thank you so much, Anshuman and Sumita, for the great insight. We have very limited time left for Q&A section. We have had overwhelming response from our listeners. We would request both of you to try and answer as many questions as we can. The first question is for you, Anshuman. Would you share your experience on dealing with shortlisted candidates, you know, dropping out in the last minute? And how was the situation handled in Honeywell, and what interventions were done to avoid recurrence?
Yeah, I mean, it's a great disappointment at any point in time if a candidate drops out, but you can't prevent that, guys. What you can do is to prevent it, create an EWS mechanism, early warning signs, make sure that you're well connected with the candidate, with the recruiter or whichever function is well connected with the candidates at all times. And the moment you spot a disconnect or a disengagement happening, put across that EWS immediately to all stakeholders, staffing, HR, and hiring managers. You can't kill this problem, but yes, often it's about surprises. EWS mechanism to kill surprise. Give the bad news. People don't mind hearing the bad news if you go with the bad news and a solution in time.
Thank you, Anshuman. There is another question now for Sumedha. There's a question from Sareen. It is understanding this is very important for recruiters and sources to support in hiring. What are the challenges in training the sources and recruiters on the business understanding? With complex business, with which is Honeywell into, and how was that managed? I'm sure whether you have been able to understand the question. Let me know if I should repeat it.
So if I can summarize, it's the question on how do we train recruiters and sources on business acumen?
I beckon.
Okay. Okay, good question. So definitely it's not always easy because we deal with, of course, a group of people the primary focus is, of course, to kind of build the job quickly and hence, demonstrating that business acumen, knowledge of the business in order to do the search becomes extremely, I would say, critical. So a couple things which we have started doing. Number one, we do host business, sessions like business orientation sessions for our recruiters. So those are usually once a quarter wherein we request a business leader to come and address small groups in respective sites. We also make our recruiters attend induction programs. So every time when induction is happening, because induction usually covers a lot on the business, overall the policies and the overall, vision of the organization. And recruiters do kind of attend those sessions, sit in, get their understanding, and then kind of come back to the job. Last but not the least, and started something called PRIDE. And PRIDE is nothing but an abbreviation. So if I have to expand the abbreviation, it says personal responsibility in driving excellence. So we hold each recruiter to be personally responsible in order to drive experience and use those PRIDE sessions to drive multiple things. And those happens every week, every Thursday between 3 to 4 p.m. And if you have to maybe, experience a Honeywell recruiter, you kind of see how they kind of behave on those sessions. So try to give the trainings as possible so that the experience which they impart is consistent and it's standardized. So those are some of the things which we have been doing to deliver or to inject business acumen.
We have the next question for Anshuman. He said the role of recruiter is set to significantly change with this transformation. What are some of the talent advisory elements that the recruiters are expected to focus on in the new scheme of things?
Great. Yeah, not in terms of the focus area for recruiters, yes, the role has transformed and therefore, as I mentioned, the three focus areas for the recruiter is be accountable for the mix, the efficiency, engagement, and experience. overall ensure that the way the recruiting operation functions, keep the user at the center, and while we are delivering it in time, there is the transparency, is there visible value add from the recruiter standpoint. That answered the question. I mean, those are three things that we were looking at for the recruiters to perform.
I think I'll answer the question, Anshuman. The next question from our listener, Anju John, is for Sumida. When you say alignment with HR, what is the role expected from the HR teams in Honeywell?
So definitely HR plays a very, very important role in our organization. And HR generalist role is a role wherein, you know, the respective HR generalist is responsible for end-to-end, I would say, HR delivery of the organization. And staffing definitely becomes a key part of that, right? So if you really want to influence the business, impact the business, business and their growth, the best way to, I would say, or one of the best way to get that done is ensuring that they get their people quickly so they don't have any gaps in the projects, right? So our main to ensure that we do have that alignment with our HR partners, in they know how many positions they have, how many aged positions they have, where all it is stuck, how fast we need to move, and you know, bring up that visibility up to the HR partner so that they are able to remove roadblocks for us, work with the business to kind of you know, negotiate or mediate if we are facing any problem, or escalate issues or resolve issues if there are certain issues which we are facing. So that's the whole typically, and when I say that it was alignment with HR, because it was a common goal. It was not that it's a staffing team, so staffing team has to figure out how to get their jobs filled, and HR does play a role only in conducting interviews or doing comp benchmarking. It is never that way at Honeywell. It's a partnership from day one, wherein HR participates in in-tech meetings, HR works with the recruiter very, very closely to ensure that we are able to fill the job fast for the business.
Thanks, Sumida. I think we have time for just one more last question. I'm not sure who it would be addressed to. I will read the question and you can decide. What sort of recruiter to stakeholder ratio do you have? And would you have an idea on what is the best practice ratio? This question by Praveen Nair.
Sumida, would you like to take it up?
Maybe Anshuman can add on. So we didn't map it, at least in Honeywell, we didn't map it with the stakeholders. Definitely we mapped our recruiter basis the HR organization. So the cohorts are created or the pairings are done is typically HRG, HRBP will have one recruiter to kind of work with, right? So the HRBP is supporting two groups, there might be one recruiter who is supporting that two groups. So we created that cohorts keeping HRBP ratio in mind, and I think typically at any point in time, if I talk about the requisitions, and a recruiter is equipped to handle close to about 15 to 20 requisitions at any point in time, at least in the organization. Anshuman, would you like to talk about the ideal number?
Actually, Sumida, in terms of numbers per recruiter, it's it depends heavily from industry to domains to etc. But yeah, typically across RPOs, we look at a number for about 15 to 20 recs to be there. 15 on the lower side, 20 on the high side. That's the number that we benchmark on, and Honeywell, we've kept the same number.
Thank you, again, Anshuman and Sumedha, with this last question here. We are going to wrap up of today's webinar. We have a lot of questions waiting for both of you, so I request Anshuman and Sumedha to take them offline for listeners who are really eager to have answers to their questions. Once again, we thank today's webinar partner, PeopleStrong. Special thanks to our speaker, Anshuman and Sumedha, for this webinar and invaluable information that they have shared with us today. I would like to thank everybody in the webinar audience for participating in today's presentation. Stay tuned for many more such exciting sessions. Thank you and have a nice day.